Despite watching Neon Genesis Evangelion and the end of Evangelion, and thoroughly enjoying both elements of the EVA continuity, I had never seen the Rebuild series until now, which is why I will be detailing and documenting my takeaways and first impressions of Hideaki Anno's retelling of the Evangelion story. Hello Funkers, welcome to the first episode of my four-part Evangelion Rebuild Analysis series. In this first episode, we will be looking at Evangelion 1.1, You Are Not Alone, as an addition to the Evangelion Legendarium, and how this first subdivision of the story as a standalone film was meant to highlight the loneliness experienced by Shinji, Misato, and Rei. Though a lot of this film is a frame-by-frame reproduction of the original anime, there are significant changes in tone and structure incurred by the introduction of instrumental characters, see what I did there? And concepts presented sooner than in the anime. Despite a lot of repeated elements, I will be reviewing this film as an original piece of art as opposed to an alternate retelling of Evangelion, because I believe that the Rebuild series was intended to stand alone as an upgraded continuity of the story. Occasionally, I will compare and contrast the implications of some changes in the story and the differences in impact between the two media, but I will not review the movie in accordance to its fidelity to the original anime. Also, to keep my reviews exciting, at the time of this recording, I have not seen any of the other Rebuild films and intend to make my reactions and reviews as I watch them. Without further ado, let's dive in and analyze the themes and preliminary rhetoric of the first installment of this psychological tetralogy. The film opens with impersonal shots of Tokyo 3 scattered throughout before introducing both Misato and Shinji. Shinji is introduced after presumably arriving to the city via a train, only to realize that the city's under attack by a gigantic humanoid monster, later revealed to be an angel. Misato, on the other hand, is seen driving towards Shinji's location, perfectly aware of what's going on. While the city appears to throw everything it's got to combat the angel, Misato and Shinji make their way towards Nerve headquarters while being rocked about by the ensuing battle. On the drive, Misato attempts to speak to Shinji about the big elephant in the room, i.e. the big angel in the city, but Misato notices that Shinji's behaving ambivalent toward everything, including the frighteningly one-sided battle between a military force and a single angel. Eventually, Shinji and Misato make their way into Nerve's headquarters, while Shinji is immediately asked by his father Gendo to pilot the EVA and engage the angel in combat after not seeing Shinji in 3 years and having had abandoned him when he was 3 years old. Shinji understandably refuses, and Gendo decides to summon Rei Ayanami, whom at the time is looking like an ICU patient. While the angel wreaks havoc above Nerve headquarters and causes many earthquakes, Rei is violently thrown off her stretcher, and Shinji, upon helping her on the stretcher again, notices Rei's blood covering his hand and cementing the fact that nobody else can get into the Evangelion but him. This is the first real meaningful difference between the film and the anime, because it makes Shinji look slightly more dutiful, perhaps also taking pity over Rei's devastating state. As we could all expect, Shinji completely gets his ass whooped by the angel, initially falling after taking his second step in this gigantic cyborg. But anyway, Shinji immediately gets pulled back up and has his EVA's arm twisted. Shinji realizes then that whatever the EVA can feel, he can also feel, for the most part. This angel wasn't just about to do some jujitsu and bounce though, because he picks up Unit 1 and with an oscillating beam of light punctures a clean hole through its cranium, thus presumably killing the EVA Shinji was controlling. But little do we know that Unit 1 has more secrets than meets the eye, and goes into what is colloquially known as Berserk Mode. In this mode, all of the restrictive software that can be controlled remotely from Nerve's headquarters ceases to affect Unit 1, in addition to Shinji's attempts to control it. After going berserk, Unit 1 acts significantly more violent and gets the upper hand over the fourth angel. By the way, I guess this angel is called the fourth angel. More explanations will come later as the series progresses, but just so we know, this is the fourth angel. So anyway, the fourth angel attempts to pull a predator sore loser tactic, only to prove futile to Unit 1's berserk plot armor. Durability. We get a short scene after the battle of Shinji's mom and Gendo discussing the name of their future child, with his mom Yui leaving the naming up to Gendo, with Shinji being the name if the baby's a boy, or Rei if the baby's a girl. We then get a quick cut of ghostly looking Rei, and immediately after we find Shinji regaining consciousness in a hospital room back at Nerve headquarters. Exposition follows when we see Gendo have a conversation with Sela members in a dark and shady room. Here it is revealed that Gendo is actually working for Sela and trying to uphold some kind of deal with Lilith, and in order to do that, he has to play the side of humanity's protector under Nerve. We also hear that Sela's ultimate goal is to undergo the Human Instrumentality Project before we're blueballed in information. Later, we see Shinji's assigned an apartment to live under Nerve headquarters. However, Misato quickly intervenes and decides to look after him as a roommate, since she doesn't believe it's a good idea to leave a depressed 14-year-old alone. As she takes him to her apartment, she decides to have a detour in order to show Shinji and the audience more exposition about Tokyo 3, which is a city designed exclusively for the purpose of fighting angels, coming with the ability to Diglett its way out of an angel attack. Shinji finally gets to move in, and after realizing that Misato is a depressed slob and has a data penguin, or whatever the hell Pen Pen is, he begins to start to come to terms with his new role as a protector in Tokyo 3, something which will bring him more harm than good in the immediate aftermath, as he is punched in the face by Tochi, one of his classmates, due to the fact that Shinji's battle with the fourth angel caused his sister to be injured. We get a little dialogue between Misato and Ritsuko, where they discuss their concern with Shinji operating Unit 1. After realizing that Shinji has undergone a life full of pain, they question whether or not Shinji could ever reintegrate into a normal life, citing Misato's frustration to connect with him and Shinji's lack of personal ambition. We also get a spelled out form of exposition regarding the hedgehog's dilemma, which causes people to isolate instead of risking hurting others in order to feel closer to them. Shortly after this scene, Rei informs Shinji that there is a new state of emergency and that she will be able to handle it, thus ushering in the fifth angel. Shinji willingly mans Unit 1 and, despite his conflictions about the reason why he chooses to pilot the EVA, engages the fifth angel in combat. Shinji, however, realizes that he is not prepared to take on this opponent, as his Gatling gun smoke obscures his visibility and he gets his umbilical cable severed, leaving him with 5 minutes to kill the angel or retreat before Unit 1 loses all power. While this is going on, Shinji realizes that Toji and his friend Kensuke are both dangerously close to the battle, and he allows them to take refuge in his entry port. During the fight, however, Shinji disobeys Misato's orders to retreat, and Shinji decides to take matters into his own hands, killing the angel with 1 second shy of powering down under the pretext that he can no longer run away from his fears. This, of course, being reckless behavior, gets Shinji reprimanded by Misato, and causes him to run away from Nerve and attempt to survive on the streets. This escape is short-lived, however, since upon realizing that all exits out of the city are destroyed, Shinji decides to give Nerve another chance, because, I mean, he doesn't have any other options, right? And he accepts his job as an EVA pilot. We also see Shinji reconcile with Toji as he and Kensuke form a friendship with Shinji. We then get a flashback of the event that caused Rei Ayanami's injuries, as seen at the beginning of the film. During this scene, we see Rei undergoing a test run in Unit 0, when all of a sudden Unit 0 goes berserk and Rei is forced to be ejected from the EVA as it has its power cut. Gendo is seen jumping towards the entry plug and ripping the door open despite sustaining severe burns to his hands, much uncharacteristic of his stoic and emotionless demeanor. Shinji too gets to see this side of Gendo, however, when we time skip to present day and get a Shinji POV of Gendo speaking to Rei and seeing both of them acting like normal human beings for once, much to Shinji's chagrin and bewilderment. After being asked to deliver Rei's renewed Nerve ID card, Shinji curiously explores her depressing and minimalist apartment looking for clues or any indication of Rei's closeness to Gendo. It is here where we see Shinji getting caught for snooping around by Rei as she exits the shower. Instead of showing any semblance of embarrassment or shame, Rei reacts nonchalantly to Shinji's intrusion and proceeds to rip Gendo's glasses off of Shinji's face before we get the forced fanservice-y scene where Shinji falls on Rei and manages to get, an accidental grope in. Though Shinji is never composed enough to ever get the point and explain to Rei why he was summoned to her apartment in the first place, Rei seemingly leaves without caring enough to hear Shinji's explanation. It isn't until much further in Nerve's headquarters where Rei's badge fails to clear her through the turnstiles and Shinji finally delivers the ID card. What follows is a conversation where Shinji tries to understand how Rei is both unbothered by having to be an EVA pilot and how she is able to get as close to Gendo as she has been. Upon being asked about his confidence in his father's work by Rei, Shinji discloses that he can't trust a father as bad as Gendo, and gets promptly slapped by Rei for his lack of faith. We later see the arrival of the sixth angel and Shinji's first engagement with it. We learn that this angel has a stronger AT field than its predecessors, and can only be attacked from a distance. It proves formidable by incapacitating Shinji with two hits of its nuclear-powered beams. This attack leaves Shinji unconscious, and he is retracted from the fight while Ramiel, aka the Sixth Angel, positions itself and drills into the Geo Front. Sometime later, Shinji awakens from his coma after dreaming about a conversation with Rei, where he divulges that the only purpose of his life is to pilot the EVA, even though he hates doing it. Shinji awakens to Rei, filling him in about Operation Yashima, where she offers to fight the Sixth Angel by herself after hearing that Shinji is afraid. Misato later attempts to motivate Shinji to pilot the EVA again, as Shinji calls her and the rest of the Nerve agents hypocrites for forcing him to fight while everyone else is hiding behind a bunker. This causes Misato to give us an early exposition dump and take Shinji down to level Triple E of Nerve headquarters into a secret chamber known as Central Dogma. Here it is revealed how the third impact is supposed to come about when Misato exposes Lilith, a giant angel crucified to a cross. She explains that if the sixth angel, or any angel for that matter, reaches Lilith, it would automatically incur the end of humanity in a mass extinction event called the Third Impact. Shinji reluctantly agrees to pilot the EVA one last time after learning that everyone's life is at stake and decides to partake in Operation Yashima. We later see Shinji and Rei being briefed on the operation, which turns out to be a national effort where all of Japan's power is siphoned into Nerve's positron cannon, and Shinji gets a boost of moral support from his classmates via a recording. Later during Shinji's second fight with the angel, he misses the first shot aimed at the sixth angel's core, and as a result of not being able to kill it, puts Rei in direct harm as she takes the brunt of the angel's blast and nearly dies before Shinji gets his opening and kills the sixth angel. In a parallel sequence where Shinji, scared that Rei may have died from her injuries, busts her open from her entry plug and is relieved to find her still alive, much like Gendo had done prior to the events of the film. Rei uncharacteristically smiles after not knowing how to react to catharsis, and they share a moment of solidarity. The film seemingly ends as they both hold hands, and then we get a shot of the camera panning over to the moon, where we get a cryptic foreshadowing sequence where Kaworo, who's unnamed in this film and, you know, we're not supposed to know who he is seen emerging from a coffin on the moon and speaks to a Sila monolith about Shinji's awakening and the fulfillment of the Dead Sea Scrolls' Apocrypha prophecies. We get a glimpse of a giant Lilith-looking creature in a hole, as Kaworo states, "Not the third again, you never learn, do you?" before looking up and expressing eagerness to meet Shinji before the film ends. Alright, so how does this film set up the Evangelion plot, and what are the major overarching themes of this first installment? Well, for starters, as a condensed medium that tells 6 episodes plus of lore and plot, I found this film to be very explicit in the way that it sets up Shinji's, Misato's, and Rei's personal battles with their lots in life. Let me start with the main character, Shinji. Shinji's aversion to human connection is very pronounced since the beginning of the film. He uses the strategy of politeness to create what is known in politeness theory as psychological distance whenever he addresses to Misato, something which she picks up immediately on and calls him out for. Shinji's implied excuse for creating such a distance is the social perceived hierarchy of age between him, a 14-year-old student, and Misato, an adult professional woman, when he admits that he didn't believe anyone would purposely explain to him the phenomenon of the fourth angel. In doing so, not only do we see that Shinji's politeness was a conscious decision to keep his true personality under wraps, but also came from a belief that he was not worthy of being addressed about important matters. Immediately, we can infer that Shinji has low self-esteem, is insecure about his perceived social value, and does not want to form any interpersonal relationships with anybody. Now, I have already talked about politeness theory on this channel, so if you're interested in learning more about it, and have also happened to read the Jagan manga, I know, long shot, feel free to click the link in the description to watch this video right here. But now back to the film. Early on, we learn that Shinji was abandoned by his father as a small child, and shows a genuine curiosity as to why his father would summon him after years of abandonment, often mistaking the concept of love for his own utility. What's interesting is that despite him wanting his father's approval, he shows explicit resentment throughout multiple occasions in the film. Though somewhat contradictory, Shinji's uncomfortable view of his father seems to be consistent with a number of insecure attachment styles, most notably avoidant and anxious. Though the avoidant attachment style is the most obvious and commonly expressed style by Shinji throughout this film, when interacting with most characters, he displays a plethora of signs that indicates anxiety when it comes to his father. First, let me list off a few indicators of anxious ambivalent attachment types, and then I'll break down how they apply to Shinji's behavior. According to simplypsychology.org, anxious ambivalent types tend to hold a negative self-image and a positive image of others, meaning that they have a sense of unworthiness, but generally evaluated others positively. In addition, the child may feel hurt, rejected, and angry, holding on to this sadness no matter what comfort comes from the caregiver. The child may not make eye contact upon the caregiver's return. We can see the subdivision of anxious attachment style in Shinji quite a bit, and though not all of the indicators for ambivalent anxiety are present, a large majority of behaviors reflect this. Let's start with Shinji's self-image issues. Shinji does not value his own safety, often saying things like, "I do not deserve being protected," or "I am not needed here." These beliefs, for example, are literally the most blatantly negative self-imagey beliefs out there. Another aspect that is less obvious in Shinji about anxious ambivalent attachment styles is being distressed when a primary giver is not present. Now you're probably saying, "Tony, what do you mean?" Shinji's pretty independent in the film and even opts to stay alone when Misato offers for him to stay with her. Ah yes, great observation. But allow me to read further along and describe how this distress actually manifests itself. A child who is anxious ambivalent finds it very difficult to let go of their caregivers at times of separation. Let me highlight that last part. At times of separation. Shinji's afraid to stray away from his father, but once he is in a state of separation, he does not try to directly seek his father, which is why we see him peeping from a distance and feeling jealousy towards Rei, and how his father seems to favor her and even enjoy conversations with her. But let me keep reading. It's not just that he's anxious at a point of separation with his father, but paradoxically, he cannot and will not accept his father's love. This is super evident during the elevator scene where Shinji can't even hold eye contact with his old man. And even in the beginning of the movie, we can see how Shinji does not really want to please his dad when actually confronted with the decision to do so, when he has asked to pilot the Eva, until he sees Rei's mangled body and decides to do it out of sympathy for her. Though I can go on and on about other traits and debate whether or not I'm splitting hairs with my examples, I'd like to add another example of Shinji's anxious ambivalent attachment style, and that would be his difficulty with making friends. Since this film really went out of its way to spell out Shinji's mental problems for us, we find Ritsuko and Misato discussing Shinji's inability to want to make connections with other kids at school. Though we had already noticed that Shinji was a loner, I believe the film wanted to make the hedgehog's dilemma as unambiguous as possible during their exposition dump dialogue to highlight Shinji's attachment type. According to the same article regarding anxious ambivalent attachment types, in the school playground, the anxious ambivalent child may choose to stay close to the teacher rather than going off to play with other children, since this feels safer. Thus, they may appear unsociable and find it hard to make friends with peers. We never see Shinji stick close to the teacher or anything like that. Granted, the kid is 14, and this article is mostly referencing a younger child, but we do see him struggle to even want to make friends, and his only interactions with would-be friends ended up with him being wrongly punched in the face. Obviously, he eventually does make friends after the solidarity he shared during the Fifth Angel's attack, but it's implied that under normal circumstances, Shinji would have not made any friends had he been left alone to his own devices. Now let's talk about Misato, and why she's lonely, and why her behavior suggests that she's experiencing a specific form of sexual bereavement. During her conversation with Ritsuko in the bar, Ritsuko mentions the belief that Misato is keeping Shinji in her apartment because she's lonely, where Misato fires back with saying, "This time it's not an intimate relationship," referencing an undisclosed relationship she had 8 years prior. Though we know who it was with, we're going to pretend we don't, since we're treating this film like a standalone continuity. Misato immediately explains that the reason Shinji is still staying with her is because he wants to prove his worth to his father, rather than Misato keeping him for company at that point in the story. Normally, we would assume that Misato had suffered from some kind of strained relationship with her father, as Ritsuko later mentions he's conflicted over his father just like you are, Misato, when she likens Shinji's search for a love that will wipe away his loneliness with Misato's relationship with her father. But the fact of the matter is, that Misato was never written to be blatantly lonely. Sure, she lives with an anthropomorphic penguin as a roommate and suffers from high-functioning alcoholism, but her distinction is her hypersexuality, which transcends that of regular loneliness, at least depicted in most media. Allow me to explain. In Misato's first appearance, we see the picture she gave Shinji to identify her prior to their first meeting. In this picture, she is highly sexualized, pointing out her own breasts and leaving a lipstick kiss imprint on the picture, insinuating to Shinji that she wants to quote-unquote bang him. Now, I could have chalked this picture up to a gag, but we also get a hint that Misato has pederast tendencies when she has a phone conversation with Ritsuko, and she herself jokes about not laying a hand on Shinji, at which Ritsuko scolds her afterwards for even suggesting something like that. Though it's ambiguous if Misato would ever have any kind of inappropriate relations with a child, it is more than obvious that she is hypersexual, and as previously mentioned, it has been teased that her hypersexuality stems from a need to acquire an escape from her loneliness and traumatic past. According to London-based psychologist Martina Paglia, the grief process is about dealing with a loss that leaves a void, later adding, "Some people see an increase in libido because sex helps fill that void. Sex can also help as a distraction from the numbness, confusion, and despair that grieving entails. Other people turn to food or alcohol to fill the void." Now, one might point out that grief and trauma, though interrelated, are not the same phenomenon, and I would agree with that, which is why I turned to a study conducted for the Journal of Affective Disorders, which conducted a study based on a sample size of 1,025 subjects, 71.3% of them female, in order to place a spectrum of traumatic histories on a matrix based on a psychometric study. Then, by using multiple questionnaires as per the hypersexual behavior inventory protocols, relationships were drawn between the levels of trauma and the levels considered to be hypersexual through multiple forms of data analysis. To quote this study directly, "There was a statistically significant direct effect of post-traumatic symptoms, ITQ total, on hypersexual behavior, HB total. Furthermore, indirect effects were also statistically significant, providing support to the hypothesis that depression and guilt would be serial mediators of trauma hypersexual behavior relations. The path through depression and guilt have been found to be the most significant, with moderate and high indirect levels of hypersexuality." This study therefore concluded that, and I quote, "Hypersexuality can be considered as a reactive form of a major affective psychopathology, representing a tip of the iceberg hiding the real reasons of a suffering personality. Clinicians and researchers should therefore consider hypersexual behavior in the light of a symptomatic manifestation of a major psychopathology involving the affective aspects of personality." In other words, Misato is clinically considered to have what is known as a suffering personality, and though the motives of her suffering personality are not explicit in this film, Ritsuko's juxtaposition made between Shinji's relationship with his father and Misato's relationship with her father, on top of Ritsuko's comments insinuating that Misato brought Shinji as a roommate out of her own loneliness, more than validates the idea that Misato is experiencing traumas that have caused her to acquire a hedgehog's dilemma where she needs to be close to people because she has a void, and she can't even get close enough to them out of fears of being hurt again, so she uses hypersexuality to maintain a distance. Now finally, let's talk about Rei Ayanami now. Rei, for the most part, is a bit of an enigma, and shows the least realistic of all symptoms of isolation out of the three main characters in this film. Rei, as far as we know in the film, lives alone in a lightly furnished apartment with a concrete floor. Similarly to how little personality her living arrangements have, she too appears to have little personality of her own, the bulk of it constituted as an obsession with Gendo. Throughout the film, we see Rei being completely stoic and unbothered to most of the things happening around her without showing much disdain for her obvious unfortunate lot in life. We are initially led to believe that the reason she is willing to fight in the Eva without protest in the initial part of the film is because she doesn't have a choice and appears to be catatonic most of the time. However, this could not be further from the truth. Rei has a complex system of beliefs and ethos that has led the internet to categorize her Myers-Briggs personality type as an ISTJ, which is also known as a logistician personality type. According to 16personalities.com, logisticians are characterized as such, and I quote, "This personality type makes up a good portion of the overall population, And while logisticians may not be particularly flashy or attention-seeking, they do more than their share to keep society on a sturdy, stable foundation in their families and in their communities. Logisticians often earn respect for their reliability, their practicality, and their ability to stay grounded and logical, even in the most stressful situations. If we replace the word family for Gendo and community for Nerve, Rei falls in perfectly with this definition. Rei is more than willing to do what is asked of her and expected of her so much as to give her life for Gendo's cause, which leads me to the following observation about Rei. Rei is incredibly lonely, but unlike Shinji or Misato, who are lonely due to life circumstances and were allowed to deal with their traumas in a vacuum, Rei's case is much different, which is why classifying her psychological ailments is difficult when juxtaposed with the real world. You see, it seems that Hideaki Anno largely drew from his own personal life experiences and depression to create Shinji, and to a lesser extent Misato. Yet Rei must have been the fusing of real-world depression with a fanciful and sterile environment to produce a human with the most withdrawn human pathologies. The reason why I say that is because in the film, it is apparent that Rei's isolation was not an accident, but rather implemented by design. In most of the literature I was able to find regarding implemented isolation in children, the majority of the articles led to the conclusions that children who were forced into isolation had underdeveloped prefrontal cortexes, and were disadvantaged when it came to cognitive functions such as planning, higher-level thought, and social interaction. Higher-level thought meaning the ability to synthesize information rather than just repeating learned facts. Though this on the surface sounds exactly like Rei, we must understand that Rei goes to school with children her age and trains at Nerve's headquarters with human trainers and bosses. What is puzzling about this is that Rei is around other children who understand concepts such as friendship, romance, nudity, fun, embarrassment, and other basic human emotions, and despite that, is unable to learn about these concepts through osmosis, which is literally how all children learn about the world. Another peculiarity about Rei is her relationship with Gendo, which appears to be completely distinct in comparison to how she interacts with everybody else. We can then assume that Gendo is Rei's parental figure, but then that would imply that Rei is capable of understanding relationships, something which we do not see when Shinji tries to reach out and have conversations with Rei. We could also just assume that Rei is an extremely rude individual with anyone other than Gendo, the evidence being her coldness and her willingness to slap Shinji when he questions Gendo's methods. Yet, what suggests otherwise is the end of the film, when Shinji rescues Rei from the entry plug and she expresses not knowing how to react after a stressful situation, and after its cathartic resolution, where Shinji literally has to tell her that a smile would be an appropriate response. Another piece of evidence that refutes the idea that Rei is simply a bitch is her lack of emotional response when her personal living quarters are invaded by Shinji, when her naked body is exposed to Shinji, and when Shinji accidentally touches her breast. So what gives with Rei? How can she be lonely yet unable to realize that she's lonely, unable to feel sadness for being lonely, and yet having an environment that could potentially teach her otherwise? The answer is obviously found in the anime rather than in the film where her origin story is laid out. But even then, it is a mystery as to why she barely has any humanity in her until Shinji meets her and literally has to teach her about being a human. I believe the answer stems from being groomed through a long process of strategic sensory deprivation. Yes, Rei goes to school. Yes, Rei interacts with other adults at Nerve, but she has no furnishings, is forced into insanely dangerous situations, has a strict and controlled lifestyle, and then despite that is shown positivity by only Gendo. Gendo is the only one who seems to care about Rei, burning his hands to pull her out of the entry plug, smiling at her and congratulating her for her efforts when it comes to running tests with the EVA, and being the source of what little material wealth she has. Rei doesn't realize she is being tortured by Gendo, because she has been led to believe that Gendo's cause is an ultimate good, and that she is instrumental, therefore disregarding all the evidence that points to her life being horrible. So why is Rei so unhuman? It's because Gendo designed her to be that way, to disregard the elements of her humanity as being counterproductive to his cause, and by being Rei's only source of happiness. Gendo then is able to manipulate the life out of Rei. That is, until she meets Shinji. So, we've established that Rei is even more lonely than both Shinji and Misato, but based on the events of the film, can she even feel that loneliness? Well, to quote the book Eichmann and Jerusalem, A Report on the Banality of Evil by Hannah Arendt, in reference to Adolf Eichmann, a Nazi so dumb, vain, and mechanical that he was unable to realize that his actions were evil, she said the following. Except for an extraordinary diligence in looking out for his personal advancement, he had no motives at all. He merely, to put the matter colloquially, never realized what he was doing. It was sheer thoughtlessness, something by no means identical with stupidity, that predisposed him to become one of the greatest criminals of that period. And well, though, we can't classify Ray as being evil, it was her own personal advancement as she knew it that kept her diligently working for Gendo and isolating herself beyond recognition. In the same way that Eichmann did not realize he was evil, Ray did not realize she was lonely. In the same way Eichmann was just a salaryman doing his job, Ray was just a little girl trying to please her father figure. Alright, now after watching Evangelion 1.1, you are not alone. I see Hideaki Anno's irony and genius in creating that title. Every character in that film is truly alone, but if they only look towards each other rather than inwards, they could definitely remove that parenthesis. Alright everybody, I hope you guys enjoyed this review, and let me know what you guys think in the comments below. Thank you very much for tuning in, guys. I'll see yous down the road.